This is the report we have all been waiting for. Praise to the Lord. The building to serve project is complete, except for a few outdoor items that will need to be done this spring. Final inspections will take place this week. This is an incredible project that we started several years ago. I could not tell you how many work here. I could not tell you how many volunteers myself. I'll be honest with you, I can almost barely remember what things used to look like. The new addition looks like it was a subject. It was designed to be hard work. It's when you walk out of the auditorium straight across into the activity center. Chances of slipping on ice. We got a new space for a new classroom. Our final classroom, God and you has blessed us greatly. Very shortly, we will be giving you the final numbers of the project, the final numbers of the closed section. But we have much to thank God for. In connection with that, on the 20th of February, that's a month away, but on February 20th, we will have a special service of dedication. We're going to alter the schedule a little bit that day, but we really, as God's people, are not grateful for what He has done and allowed us to do. It's something like that. So, you mark your calendars for the 20th of February. That will be a service of dedication for the creation of the facility that God has given us. You know me in numbers. As we've gone through, we have some folks stopped by and spoke to Cindy on Friday.
Monday, Tuesday, I'll be doing the meetings at the township hall that will be dealing with the construction and the operation of the marijuana facilities, and then I'm asking Christians to pray. When you pray, then you'll call upon your Jews to go to the meeting spot and pray. Monday's meetings at 6:30, Tuesday's meetings at 7 o'clock, but we have some fellow Christians that ask us to pray about it for a talk that part. Grateful that Wyatt Mass is home and continuing to heal. We continue to pray for his healing. Grateful for the Lord's help. His life took him to the door. Surgery to keep his goal was in last week. He's home. But again, as he recovers, prayer would be appreciated. Dr. Johnson called the last one that his sister has COVID and is very sick. So lots of things to ask God for. Lots of things to praise God for. A completed project. We're going to hear about a ministry that our church has been supporting that reaches out to the next community. We have folks who have been ill that are doing better. We have folks that are still needing a touch from the Lord. So let's pray. That's his blessing on the day today. Father, thank you this morning for the ability that we have to be together. Thank you that we can worship you. And thank you, Lord, for the desire that you put in our hearts to worship you. Father, I would ask this morning as we lift our voices to sing, as we listen to your word, as we fellowship our hands at the table, that all that is said and done would bring honor and bring glory to the name. Father, thank you for what you did in the moment of death, for the intent and purposes of the pursuit of righteousness and truth. Father, I start with this, that it's just a thought, committee after committee, meeting after meeting, all of the effort that went into the planning, the building, forward to next month when we dedicate a whole service to doing just that, to praising you, to thanking you, to glorifying your name, to acknowledging the fact that we have what we have because you were pleased to give it to us. And by pledging to use what you've given to us for our good, your glory, until you come upon it, what an exciting time it will be. We pray for those who continue to be laid aside. We pray for the gift, bringing us masters to the beyond. We ask, Lord, that the medication he's receiving would do its job. We know, Lord, that he struggles with various suffering health issues, and we ask that you would be pleased to help those come under control. We pray for our friend Sandy, who received a doctor's call. Heart surgery. Father, thank you that you've given us physicians who are able to do miraculous things to heal your body. Thank you that Tim Herman and beyond have successful surgeries, and ask for them to continue I'm going to go to the next slide. morning, if you have it, turn please to Acts chapter 20. The book of Acts, chapter 20. I'm going to consider this morning the first 12 verses that the title of today's message is, Are You Awake? Acts chapter 20, beginning with verse 1, the Bible says this: After the uproar had ceased, Paul said to the disciples, and when he had exhorted them and taken his leave of them, he left to go to Macedonia. When they had gone through those districts and had given them much exhortation, he came to Greece. And there he spent 3 months. And when the plot was formed against him by the Jews, as he was about to set sail for Syria, he decided to return to Macedonia. He was accompanied by Sopater of Berea, the son of Tyrus, and by Aristarchus and Sabinus of the Thessalonians, and by Gaius of Derbe and Timothy, and Tychicus of Philemon. Tychicus, you're about to have a son. You could name him Tychicus. And Tychicus and Trophimus of Asia, the peace of God on ahead, and they were waiting for us at Troas. We sailed from Philippi under the days of unleavened bread and came to them at Troas within 5 days. And then we stayed 7 days. That first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread, Paul began talking to them, intending to leave the next day, and he prolonged his message until midnight. There were many lands in the upper region where we were gathered together. There was a young man named Eutychus sitting on the windowsill, sinking into a deep sleep. As Paul kept on talking, he was overcome by sleep. He fell down from the third floor and was picked up. But Paul went down and fell upon him, and after embracing him, he said, Do not be troubled, for his life is in him. As he climbed up on the top and had broken the bread in two, he talked with them all the long while until daybreak. And he left. He took away the royal life. Believe it or not, we began our study in the book of Acts 1 year ago last Sunday, April 9th, 2021. You're probably remembering that the sermon title for our sermon a year ago last Sunday was Mission Impossible. Remember that? We were about to embark on a study of the Acts of the Apostles and the things that we see happening in the local church almost seemed impossible. Well, I reminded you then that I had taken the title of that message from the TV improvement series, What a Mission Impossible. They follow the fictional body as the impossible mission force to undertake missions that were, well, impossible. Instructions are given in a clandestine way. Your mission, should you choose to accept it, they would always be, yes, that's always. If you or any of your IMF team members are caught or killed, the secretary will disavow you in the language of your actions. This tape will self destruct in 5 seconds. Good luck. And the next hour or two is filled with adventure as the mythical death breaks and James Phelps and Ethan Hunt perform amazing feats to accomplish this impossible mission. We listened 1 year ago as we began to open this book, the Acts of the Apostles, as the Lord Jesus says to his disciples, But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, even to the remotest parts of the earth. And I wonder in this past year, have we as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ recognized the fact that we indeed have been filled with power? Have we been living that way? Have we been seeking to be the representatives, the witnesses of the Lord? as I closed that sermon one year ago last Sunday, I asked the following question. Question number one. What motivates you as a believer? Why do you do what you do? Question number two. How do you function as a believer? How do you do what you do? Question number three was, what is your emphasis as a believer? Do you give the highest priority to the things that are important to God? As we get to chapter 20, we have covered two-thirds, a little over two-thirds of the book of Acts. We're on the homework stretch now. May I ask you, having studied through 20 chapters or 19 chapters of the book of Acts, having seen what believers filled with the power of the Holy Spirit are capable of doing, may I ask you, has your answer to any of those questions changed? Just as you are sitting in a church service this morning, our text this morning is a church service, a dear big church. One of the main characters in our text this morning, Jesus the King, good man. During the service of the local church. And I want to be honest with you, that's something that I have done myself. I have been done too close to sleep during the church. Although I typically don't do that anymore. Two reasons. Number one, I'm not going to be speaking. But number two, when I'm listening to someone else speak, I have this problem. I still feel like it's my job. But I used to fly a lot during the time when I would wake myself up. And there's nothing more embarrassing than being in the church. Now, being in the culture, being in your Bible, or praying isn't over. You know, you're praying. When the Bible falls off your lap, and everybody knows, it's just like when you snore, everybody knows that you're going to die. I wonder if Luke, when he tells us about Judas, following his lead, I wonder, was he just dancing in the face? Not, the Apostle Paul was preaching past midnight, preached all night long, preached until midnight. He was so doggone boring that he just fell asleep for like a week. I'm sure there's another purpose. And I'm sure that there's something that we can, and there's something that we ought to learn. Let me remind you of the historical context as we find ourselves here in Acts chapter 20. This is during the second missionary journey Paul had visited Troas. It was in Troas that Paul heard that Macedonian Paul come down and help us. And here we are now in the third missionary journey. Most recently, Paul has been in Ephesus. And his plan is, as we think, Ephesus is to return to Jerusalem. He's going to do so via Macedonia. He spent some time in Greece, spending 3 months there. Most likely during that 3 month stay in Greece, he wrote the epistle to the Romans. He returns to Macedonia. He's traveling with a diverse group of people. In Philippi, he celebrates the Feast of Unleavened Bread. He reconnects with Luke. You'll notice verse 6 of chapter 20. Uses the word we. So Luke is once again reunited with the group of people Paul is traveling with him. And that's kind of important because Luke is going to be an eyewitness to the things that he is about to tell us. They arrive in Troas. And notice what their church practice was in verse 7 on the first day of the week we went, when we were gathered together to break bread. Paul began talking to them. But you realize that we don't need to be gathered together to be happy. And I think in the early church, when those Christians were gathering together because they were having that new meal, perhaps someone would say, I don't know what the practice of your house is, but typically in my house, before we have a word of prayer. There would not be nothing wrong with you the next time you're sitting in your home about to have breakfast or dinner or supper or lunch or dinner or whatever you call it, what you call your meal. There would be nothing wrong with saying, now as we take this food, we need to remember, let's pause for just a second and remember the fact that our Savior, the Lord Jesus, gave his body for us. And then as we're about to drink or water or milk or whatever it is that you're drinking in here, the church did that regularly at first. The Bible says they didn't do it. You want to know why? Because we're forgetful people. Can you imagine what would happen if three times a day as we sat down to eat, we reminded ourselves of the fact that we have a Savior who gave his all for us? Do you think that would be worth it? Clearly, now in chapter 20, we see the early church, at least now, on the first day of the week, gathering together to break bread. Of their corporate worship week after week, they would gather together and they would remind themselves of who they were and of the great cost it was to Christ to purchase their salvation. Now, it's important to know as we're looking at this text that Luke counted days and times in the Roman fashion. From midnight to midnight, not the Jewish fashion, which would be from Sunday to Sunday. So you notice again, verse 7 on the first day of the week when we were gathered together to break bread. So normal practice, this is what the church did. They gathered together on the first day of the week, which would be Sunday. In the course of their worship together, remembering the Lord was a part of that. But preaching was as well, because Paul began talking to them. Intending to leave the next day, and he prolonged his message until midnight. If anybody was in the upper room, we were gathered together. There was a young man named Eutychus sitting on the window of the night. Eutychus is an interesting character. His name means lucky. He was a fortunate man. Most likely the early church met at night. Some of those individuals would have been Jewish believers who may well have observed Sabbath rest on Saturday. We typically observe our Sabbath rest on Sunday, the first day. But realize that that's not a practice that started until about the 4th century. So sometimes when we think about the way we do things, then we look back to the Bible and see what they're doing. Yes, understand that we may not be looking at that. And since the first day of the week was not a sacred day, lots of people may well have worked all day long. And now they show up at someone's house late at night. And look at it. The bulletin says the Apostle Paul is here to preach. And you think, I have preached for a long time. You haven't seen anything yet. Because the Apostle Paul, he can preach. Now, again, I think we often ask ourselves the question, or maybe you never ask these questions, but if we believe that the Bible is inspired, then not only are concepts inspired, it is inspired, but words are inspired. Why is this in here? What difference does it make that the Apostle Paul preached a long sermon and did it despisefully for God, but it doesn't die? A text interpretation includes the fact that, well, Luke was a historian and he was just telling us what happened. One particular Sunday night, the Apostle Paul preached a long time. Some kids don't see it, some of them don't. Nobody, he's always in the church. would say it's a warning to preachers not to preach too long about making God. Don't preach too long. Because people come on the set for so long, and they only listen for so long, and even though you think that this is all good stuff, they've lost you a long time. I even read one article that said it's a picture of what the church does to young people. It's marginalized in the country, sitting in the window seat. And ultimately, you understand why. But part of it, to read this text as if nothing unusual is happening here, is to turn the hands off on long-winded preachers and the sleepy-eyed kids they sometimes want to go. To read this text as if resurrecting youth on the church rafters and everyday purposes to ignore the possibility that Eutychus was killed because he was literally marginalized, and that it was the church's preaching, not to mention the spectacular lack of a witness, that actually killed him. This story is not the question. But for us to understand preaching, one of the questions that we have to ask is the original readers of the book of Acts. When Luke talks about Eutychus falling asleep, maybe they understood sleep to me. The sleep in the Bible often has led to meanings. Number one, it could be physiological rest. Yeah. It's nighttime. It's time for bed. You are asleep. You are snoring. You're sleeping. Sometimes in the Bible, the word sleep refers to death. Remember when Jesus was talking about Lazarus, he says he's asleep, and the disciple says, well, that's good, you're sick, he's sleeping, that would be good for him, yeah. And then Jesus says, don't you guys understand anything, he's dead. Paul writes to the Corinthian believers, he says, you know, when you remember the Lord, and you don't examine yourself, and you're doing so in an unworthy manner, because of that, some of you are sick, and some Testament talks about sleep, it's talking about irresponsible behavior. You might remember what Jesus tells the parable in Matthew chapter 25 about the 10 virgins. Remember, he says that 5 of them are wise and they drink extra oil. You don't know the other 5 did? They fall asleep. And because they fall asleep, they quench the light. Believe for us as we're thinking about the fact that the Apostle Paul is now preaching his little heart out, that Eutychus is a picture of spiritual rest. A picture of irresponsible Christian behavior. And a picture of God's grace. Challenged us about the 3 questions that I asked a year ago. And I realize that it's probably impossible to predict what those questions were exactly, unless you take a few notes if it comes to those notes a year ago. But friends, we've been studying the book of Acts for a year. Has it changed us at all? Has it made any difference in our lives? Are we like Eutychus just showing up because that's what we do? Here we are, another Sunday sermon. And I'm here just like I ought to be. But deep down, I'm asleep. Deep down, I've got with the program. Deep down, God is in the things that we understand as we read the writings of Luke, that he had a number of literary things. There were a number of things that he was really interested in as he read. One of them is several that were evident in this passage. Luke loved resurrection. He was a physician. you can imagine that a physician would be very interested in those events when someone is raised from the dead. Do you realize that that doesn't happen a lot in Scripture? And besides Jesus, there are only a couple of other individuals who raised individuals from the dead. Elijah was one in 1 Kings 17. Elisha raised someone from the dead. Peter raised Tabitha or Dorcas. We studied about that in the book of Acts. And here, Paul raises Eutychus from the dead. Yet in his gospel, Luke writes about his gospel, the book of Acts. Luke writes about four events of resurrection. Jesus raises the widow of Nain's son, the resurrection of Jesus, the death of Apophis. And there's a picture, I think, that Luke wants us to see. Sleep equals death. So many Eutychus, he fell asleep. He fell out the window. And he died. Sleep equals death. The opposite of that would be then, he would wait. Another theme that Luke is particularly interested in is the theme of worship. Remember what we learned in Acts chapter 2, verse 42? And they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place in the apostles. That was early in the book of Acts. That was early after the Holy Spirit has come. The Holy Spirit came and those people were never the same. You know, like Peter, follow the Holy Spirit and you preach in a sermon. You remember the outcome was 3,000 people were added to the church. And 3,000 people are baptized and added to the church. The church keeps growing. We read in Acts chapter 2, verse 42. You know what those Christians were doing? They were devoting themselves. They wanted to be taught. They wanted to have fellowship. They wanted to break bread. They wanted to pray. And I wonder, is that a heartbeat? Are they awake? So when you hear a bulletin announcement that says, there's a fellowship meal. Sisters in Christ who've been redeemed, who are filled with the Holy Spirit. Should we not look forward to opportunities to be together, to encourage each other, to build each other up? Do you know, I caught someone last Sunday morning, and I caught myself. I almost said, did you hear the good news? I stopped, but the person was too sharp to hear what I was going to say. He said, that's what you're going to say. Two copies of the and then I had to go Tell me what the shepherds were doing. That's a question that we raise. What were the shepherds doing? Watching their flock by night. But what were they doing? They weren't sleeping. It was night. But they were wide awake. And because they were wide awake, because they were watching, isn't it amazing that God reveals to them the greatest message of the book? When the Bible, when Luke talks about Anna, it's in the temple. Do you know what, how she's described? She's described as a lady who served God day and night. She served God all the time. Do you know what Jesus does before he chooses the disciples? In Luke chapter 6, verse 12, Luke records that Jesus spent the night in prayer. What's this? He is praying. Peter, James, and John at the Mount of Transfiguration. Peter, James, and John were overcome. Chosen by the Lord Jesus to see this awesome sight. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he reports Luke 20 to 45 when he rose from prayer and gave to the disciples that found them sleeping for a sign. And said to them, why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not enter. Peter's in jail and he's about to be beheaded. He's about to be executed. You know what Peter's doing? He's sound asleep. That's a good thing for Peter. You know what that means? He wasn't worrying. He wasn't tossing and turning. He was trusting God. You know what the church was doing that night? for him. Intervened on behalf of Peter. Remember Paul and Silas went out in that jail in Philippi? They were beaten with an inch of their life. The jailer was given specific instructions to make sure they didn't escape, and they were in the inner part of the jail. Whatever they were doing. And seeing it's midnight. I don't know about you, but I have not seen midnight for quite some time. It's midnight. And they're praising God and they're singing hymns. And here we have Jesus. The same language that we used to talk about the disciples of transfiguration. Let's think about Jesus thinking about church service. What's the warning? What's the application for us? You know who was preaching about something? I thought about the church. It's awesome. No, let me ask you. If you wrote the book to the big concept that was going to be here next year, not only would you come and bet you did one different, would you? The Apostle Paul? You think the Apostle Paul would have anything good to say? Anything good to encourage the saints with? Yet, you think this is selfishly? He's not going to learn or hear or understand one thing. Being asleep will prevent Eutychus from participating in worship. Being asleep will prevent Eutychus from being a threat to what God is doing. And then this building, the new building that we have, is amazing to me. Part of the reason it's so amazing to me is because I've kind of been part of the process since day one. I've heard some of the stories. You realize this was not the first time that first time this church wanted to reach that facility. So those of you that are old timers here, you know that we've been here before. We've drawn plans before. We've taken thoughts before. Yeah. You heard Jim talk about closing on the phone, and what that number is going to be. And you might say, boy, that's a big number. Do you realize that our first number was over $1 million? You remember that? We were going to buy $1 million. And then the bank said, oh, you can't borrow that much because your place isn't worth that much. So you can only borrow $800. Some of us were going, oh, yeah. And then the idea that church bodies came out and turns out we didn't have to borrow even more money. People had given above and beyond that which was pledged. And you might not be cognizant of that, but I am. I'm trying to be awake. And say, wow, look at what God has done. Look at how He orchestrated all the details. And sometimes we go through life like we're kind of asleep. And for wide awake, we see God at work in our lives every single day. Are you awake? Are you seeing what He's doing? Because if we are, then we've got to praise Him and worship Him. But my father is asleep. He falls away from the worshiping community. He falls away into darkness. He falls away into death. And there are some of us that are going through the motions. I know about your study in Acts 1. We're awake. We want to know what God's about. We want to worship. We want to engage. Paul writes Romans and says this, written, it says he writes to the Ephesians, awake, sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of your time because the days are evil. So that you not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. As we continue to study the book of Acts, as we dedicate this new facility to the glory of God, to service to his people and our community, I wonder, in an effort to be awake, would you be willing to do the following? Would you be willing to ask God for faith? What faith to be God and his word, leaving the results? No idea what God is going to do here at First Baptist Church. You believe he can do something? You believe he will do something? Do you believe that he wants to use you and he wants to use me? I have that father from Mark chapter 9 who has a son that's demon possessed. His son's being thrown into the fire and that people are trying to destroy him. And dad says to the Lord Jesus, Lord, if you can do anything, look pity on us and help us. And Jesus says, if you can't, who do you think you're talking to? Do you know who I am? All faith. Psalmist challenges us as we seek to stay awake, to fight God, to search you of God, and you'll find it. Try me, and you'll find that, and see if there be any wicked ways in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting. I've asked the question this morning by the sermon titled, Are You Awake? May I challenge you, don't answer the question yourself. Would you be willing to pray? Yes, God, to search your heart today. God, I want you to wait. Search me. Try me. See if I'm really awake or not. Don't give me your answer. Give me God's answer. And if the answer is no, the author of Hebrews says, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and be obedient. Not forsaking a whole assembling together, this is the habit of some, but encouraging one another all the more as you see the day. That God puts together in our body because he's a teacher. Are you willing to commit to being awake to stay yourself? To be a participative part of this body? I'm saying you don't come to First Baptist Church for you. I hope a sermon is helpful. I hope the fellowship is helpful. But we really come to be what he did. So if you're trying to decide whether you stay with first and watch about me, I say, well, I don't need another meal. I'm not going to come, but I'm going to. It's not for you. You realize that the person who's sitting beside the table might be keeping your smiling face. They might need to hear from one that came to them today. If you said, God, I want to be with you. I want to see you. I believe you. Study the book of Acts, we would see how many believed among those believers. we want you to do that for us. We're not useless. We're not sitting in the window seat. This illustration of Judas. He shows us exactly who we ought not to be. But I don't know exactly what you want to do in our lives as an individual, but what you plan to do in our life as a church body. But we want to confess this morning that we belong to you. And we're willing to say to you, here we are, to take us and use us. However you want, whenever you want. Keep us from being complacent. Keep us from just going through the motions. We want to be alert for what you're doing. We want to be involved in what you're doing. Wake us up. Especially as we see your temptation. Father, thank you for the opportunity that we're going to have in just a moment or two to fellowship. Thank you for the food that has been provided for each man that has made it. God, I would ask that around our table for fellowship would be sweet as you are reminded of the fact that we have the relationship with your blessed Son. As we finish this great book of Acts, continue to work on our hearts. So much for being here this morning. Remember, fellowship lunch right out the door. I'm going to show you tables in the foyer, tables in the activity center, and then we'll be here for the representative friends and members of the board.